glory, risen conquering Son. Endless is the victory thou, O death, hast won. And no more we doubt thee, glorious Prince of Life. Life is not without thee, aid us in our strife.
If Jesus comes tomorrow to spend some time with you, would you answer all his questions or lie to hide the truth? Would you welcome him with open arms or even let him in? If Jesus comes tomorrow, if Jesus calls your number, could you leave here today? Are you ready to lay down your worldly goods and walk away? Would it take a month of Sundays just to tell him all your sin? If Jesus comes tomorrow, what then? If the sky turns black as midnight in the middle of the day, and somehow you would soon be on his way, would you have to beg forgiveness, or could you reach out and take his hand? If Jesus comes tomorrow, what then? Just black as midnight in the middle of the day, and somehow you knew that Jesus would soon be on his way, would you have to beg forgiveness, or could you out and take his hand? If Jesus comes tomorrow, what then? If Jesus comes tomorrow, what then?
Take your Bible, if you would, and turn to Psalm number 38. In the first verse, if you look at the first verse of Psalm 38, because we want to look at the context here, it says, O Lord, rebuke me not in thy wrath, neither chasten me in thy hot displeasure. rebuke means to convict, to correct. In other words, don't correct me when you're angry. Chasten is the idea of discipline, God disciplining us to change us. But he says, don't discipline me in your hot displeasure or your rage of anger. And God hates sin. He feels violently against sin. There's no question. We are foolish to think that the sins of anyone are small, insignificant, or of little importance. If there's sins in my life, there's sins in your life, in the pastor's life, in anybody's life, sins are important. And God has a severe feeling of anger in regard to sin. And thankfully, since we're saved, we can ask the Lord to cool down a little bit before he disciplines us, and ask him to not deal with us when he's really angry. He's in the business of correcting his children. And while the Bible does refer to God chastening the wicked, he's got some things to teach this world, without a doubt. But generally, the Lord is dealing just with his children when it comes to chastening. And if you're saved, then every one of us will be chastened. Every one of us will be corrected by God. Even David wondered, he says, the wicked spread themselves like the green bay tree. And everything in life just seems to go well for them, as he described in the Psalms. And people get away with a lot of sins. One of the reasons they get away with things like that is because they are not God's children. They're the devil's children. The Lord spoke to the Pharisees and said, ye of your father the devil, and the lusts of your father you will do. He was a murderer from the beginning. He was implying that they intended to murder him. And they're the devil's children. And the Lord has punishment ahead for all those who are lost. He has punishment and the suffering of hell. But that's not for the child of God. For us who are saved, we have the correction of the Lord in this life. And he's busy correcting us and teaching us things and helping us to grow and helping us to change. And that we be like the Lord Jesus Christ and continually change more like him. In verse 2, it says, for thine arrows stick fast in me, and thy hand presseth me sore. Now, I often say that there's nothing in the scriptures really that indicates that David was he was injured in battle. With all the battles that he was in, you'd think he'd been injured. But then as I got looking at this, even though various commentators, I couldn't find anybody that said that the arrows that were in him were actual arrows from an enemy, but the context here indicates that that's caused a wound, and that wound begins to fester, and David begins to wonder if he's even going to live or if he's going to die. He's got some serious problems going on. Thine arrows could have been the enemy's arrows, because God uses a lot of different things to accomplish his will. And so I think they were real arrows. And he talks about thy hand presseth me sore. It comes down on me. Thy hand comes down with violence against me. He says, there's no soundness, verse 3, in my flesh because of thy anger. Neither is there any rest in my bones because of my sin. David recognizes that the Lord is dealing with him, and that the things that are happening to him are happening because of a sin in his life. Some particular sin, when there's no reference made to what it was or anything. There could have been anything, because you look in your own life, it could have been a lot of different things there too. Verse 4, he says, for mine iniquities are gone over my head as a heavy burden. They are too heavy for me. Over my head is the idea I'm drowning in all of this that's going on, and in the suffering for the chastening of God that's happened, and for his sin, and I'm overwhelmed. They're too heavy for me. It's too much for me to deal with. And there's a lot of things that go wrong with us in life, and sometimes it's your health. That's what's dealt with here. Sometimes you have sickness. And that sickness is because God is correcting you for something. He's correcting us for something we think, or he's correcting us for something we've said or done, or something that we need to learn. God's trying to teach us, and that's the only way that we're going to learn. But there's other things. There's trouble at work. There's appliances breaking down. The car breaks down. There are problems with people who maybe seem to like you. are now disliking you, and all sorts of things. And when things happen, we would be wise if we would check ourselves before the Lord and say, is this because of something in my life? Is this because of some sin that God is correcting me? You need to check that first before you put your name on the prayer list and ask if your health would be improved, or if things would go well, or at work, or some other problem that we have. The first thing we need to look at is we need to look up to the Lord and say, Lord, are you trying to teach me something? Is there something wrong with me that this is coming into our life? And I think even God chastens us by bringing trouble into the lives of people that we love, because that will pull on your heart as well. And our need is to repent. We have so many sins. And discipline comes to our life in many ways. And we need to learn to change our ways. We need to learn to repent and change our mind about things in our life. We need to confess our sins. We need to admit them, and our own wickedness, and then get on with praying for the things that you don't like in your life, or the health problems you have. Get on with praying with that. But first, say, why is this happening? What did I do? What do I need to learn? What's wrong in my life? Now, David, in this psalm, he knew that he had sinned. And he knew that the things that happened to him happened as a direct result of that, that God was chastening him because of what he was dealing with in his life. And if you look with me, look down to verse 16, we read, for I said, talks about, look, he's referring to what he has going on. Hear me, lest otherwise they should rejoice over me. When my foot slippeth, they magnify themselves against me. When he talks about his foot slipping here, he's talking about doing another sin or the same sin again. He's saying, I got to be careful, he said, because there are people who would just be so glad to see me fall into another sin, and they'll magnify themselves against me. Verse 17 says, for I'm ready to halt, I'm ready to stumble, I'm ready to fall down. And my sorrow is continually before me. He's talking about mental as well as physical problems. In verse 5, he talked about his wounds stinking. He talks about a loathsome disease in verse 7, which is a reference to a fever that he had. He talks about, in verse 10, his heart panteth, which has to do really with his thoughts. His thoughts were going round and round. And he didn't know what to do about it. But here he talks about his sorrow, mental and physical pain that he had, things that were bothering. And he says, my sorrow is continually before me. Verse 18, for I will declare mine iniquity. I'll declare it. The word declare there in the Hebrew means to stand opposite yourself. Boldly stand opposite yourself. Well, really, when we sin, then we're on one side and God is on the other. To confess your sins is to agree with God what God says about your sin. Say the same thing that God says about your sin. That's what he's saying here. He says, I'm going to stand opposite myself. What he really means, I'm going to stand over here where God is. And I'm going to condemn me. Just like God is saying that there are things wrong in my life, I'm going to agree with him. I'm going to declare what I've done wrong. And it might have even been a public declaration. And then he says, I'll be sorry for my sin. Now, sometimes people teach their children, you know, every time they do something wrong, you should, if you smacked your sister, then you should say sorry. And and so you make your child say sorry, but there's no sorrow in their heart. They'd smack her again if they had a chance. And, you know, the Bible teaches us to confess our sins, not to just be sorry for our sins. The word sorry here means more to be troubled. It means to be anxious. I'm going to be careful now that I have sinned. I'm going to be careful to deal with it properly. and before God. And the word declare has to do with confessing his sins. The sorrow has to do with being serious about sin. We all need that. We all need to be serious about sin. And because when my foot slippeth, I was raised just the other side of Delaware on a hog farm, and we had heavy clay around the barn, and it was all heavy clay, and it's just like walking on ice sometimes when that's got rain on it. You wouldn't believe how easy it is if the ground is sloping at all. Just sleeping, walking along, your foot just slide right out and fall right down. And David is referring to that, but he would fall into sin. And he didn't want to fall into sin again. Now, let's look to Romans for a moment. Romans chapter 6 in your Bible. Romans 6. I want to look at two things here. Romans 6, if you look down to verse 16. Romans 6, 16. Know ye not that to whom ye yield yourselves servants to obey, his servants ye are to whom ye obey, whether of sin unto death or obedience unto righteousness. Whoever you yield yourself to, his servants you are. What does it say? It's saying if we give in to temptation, as soon as we do any sin, we become a slave to that sin. That we become a servant to that sin. And that's why sin is always easier to do a second time. And it has a certain control over you. The Bible teaches this. And the sins that we resist and refuse have no power like the sins that we have surrendered to and allowed to take control of our life. There's a mastery of sin over us. Look up to verse 12. Let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body, that you should obey it in the lust thereof. Let not sin reign. Reign wants to get on a throne above you. Sin wants to be in control of you, and you subject to it. And so the Bible tells us don't allow that to happen. Don't go into sin, because when you do, sin will try to reign over your mortal body. It'll work in your body that you should obey it in the lust thereof. What's it saying? It's saying if you sin, the sins that you have done are the sins you can do again very easily. And generally, if a person is backsliding, they will backslide into the same sins that they were doing before they were saved. Now, I was never into drinking, and I thank God for that. Because my parents were pretty strong and they're about that, against that. And so if I backslide, I'm not likely going to backslide into that sin, because that was never my sin. But if that was your sin, then that's a greater danger to you than it is to me. Do you understand? Sin has a power over us. Once we do a sin, then it has a power to take a hold of our lives. Don't let it reign, the Bible says here. Let not sin reign. You shouldn't do that. And, of course, it's our choice. We can have the victory in the Lord Jesus Christ. In Psalm 73, David is describing the prosperity of the wicked. He's describing that makes them proud because they think that life has gone so well because of what they did. Unsaved people think that. They say, you know, look at me. Look at the career I've had. Look at the money I made. Look at the things I have. Look at me, how I'm important. I have to, you know, I'm the boss at work or whatever it might be. And people do that. And in Psalm 73, verse 6, it said, pride compasseth them as a chain. Pride has surrounded them like a chain around their neck. And pride is directing their life. And so everything they talk about, it's pride. It's I did this, I did that. Look at me about something else. It's always pride. And they think they've made life go well. They think they're the ones responsible for the fact they made money. And they don't know that God is the one that gave them that opportunity, because he's the one that allows anybody to be rich. The sin of pride begins to control their life and every thought. is about look at me and they don't realize that God gave them the breath to breathe and the strength to get out of bed in the morning, and they think they did it all. But any sin can become a chain about our necks. Sins of the flesh or sins of the spirit, whether it's spiritual sins like greed or speaking evil of others, or the really bad sin of unbelief, of not putting faith in God, the sin that lost people have, that they have not believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, and it's taking them to hell. Sins like jealousy or envy or spite or bitterness against others. These are sins of the spirit. And they can take a real control over us. And that's why this psalm, Psalm 38, is called a psalm of David to bring remembrance. In other words, it was written, and when it was given to him by God, David put this title over it and said, I want this to remind me of the sin I've done, to remind me where I have fallen so I don't fall there in the future. And it's like if you walk down the laneway, the barn, the tractor, we put ruts all over the place. I hauled manure every Saturday. I hauled all the manure for the hog barn and then spread it in the fields. You should have seen the ruts that we... And you walk along, boy, you could fall into that rut, but you only did that once. And the next time, you went around it far enough that you wouldn't slip in there again. And we ought to learn something from what God is trying to teach us. And do not let sin win in our lives and let it take control over us. There's one other thing I got to look at here. Back to Romans chapter 6. And I want to notice this. This is really important for all of us. Romans 6 and verse 16. Now watch what we read. Know ye not that to whom ye yield your servants yourselves, servants to obey, his servants ye are, to whom ye obey. But watch this. Whether of sin unto death, because sin always takes to death. That's where it always goes. Or of obedience unto righteousness. In other words, if we're doing right, if we're choosing to obey the commandments of God, there comes a control from that over our lives also. The control from doing what is right. And the longer you do right and obey God, the more it makes you its servant. It gains the control of our lives. Habits and keeping the commands of God become a blessed controlling factor and influence in our hearts and lives. And we need to take advantage of that. If God is convicting us of something, and many times people have gotten so used to it, they don't even know if God is convicting them because they didn't listen last time God convicted you. And you grieved away the Spirit of God. But then the Lord brings trouble, and trouble should always bring to our minds, is something wrong with me? Why is there this trouble? Is there something to learn? And many people, rather than responding to the Spirit of God, and that will just drag themselves through another day, and their song and their joy in life is so reduced, or it's even gone. And they need to go back with the psalmist and say, "Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation." And we need to deal with sin. Our society is so evil, but society has always been evil. The world has always been wicked. And in our day to day, though, there are a lot of things that are open that never used to be. Out in the open and flagrant and defying God. And sex is selling everything. And pornography is all over the internet. Anybody who's on the internet, no matter what filters you have, you're on the internet a lot, you're going to run into some picture that you shouldn't be seeing. And the same with your phone. Sometimes people just scroll and scroll and scroll. And you do that, you're going to see something immoral. You're going to see something that's dirty. And movies are full of nudity, and even on the television, and sexual content. If you watch that, that's going to pollute your mind. It's going to have an influence on that, on you. They're called dirty pictures. That's what they've always been called. They're called dirty pictures for a reason. That's what they do to your soul. When I was farm mechanic at Sheridan Nurseries, when I was pastoring in Port Hope, we had 800 acres, and so we had a lot of machinery to take care of. And the building was that had been converted into a garage. It was really an old house. And so it was a two-bay garage downstairs and then a parts room. And then upstairs, there was nothing. Some things got thrown up there. And I had to go up there sometime. And I went up there, and there was pin-up girls all over the place, like really bad. And after I was there a little while, I had to start the fire in the morning the boss hadn't got started. I had to start. There was just two of us worked in that shop. And so I went and got one of the pinup girls. I started a fire with it. Every time I went upstairs, I rolled up one, came down with it, put it in the fire. And one, Neil Shepherd, was my foreman. He went upstairs one time and he said, "What happened to all the girls upstairs?" He said, "You burned them, didn't you, Joe?" Yeah, amen. He didn't have to wonder whether I took them home or not. He knew I was burning them. And we've got to be careful about what you are watching that's polluting your soul. And you looking at all this stuff. You got a secret file on your phone or on your computer. Something on there that you like to look at. It's the same for women, a little bit different for women. I can't say I understand women, but I understand men. Even if you don't have anything hidden away somewhere that you look at, you can still be defiled. And nothing sticks in the mind like filthy pictures stick in the mind. That sort of immorality. Things you saw in the past. Dirty jokes that you heard at work that someone said. Well, that'll stick in your mind. Forget everything else, but you'll remember stuff like that. And those are the sins that are ruining your life, even if you don't admit it. That's the sort of sins that are influencing you. You need to learn to paint over those thoughts with the blood of Jesus Christ and close the door in your mind to them and ask God to forgive you every time that comes through. Our Lord told us in Matthew 15:19, He said, "For out of the heart proceed evil thoughts, murders, adulteries, fornication, thefts," which is stealing, "false witness," which is lying, "blasphemies," which is evil speaking about God. Now, adulteries and fornications and evil thoughts, the Lord said, out of your heart. These are the things that defile a man, He said. And they come from out of your heart. We can't let these thoughts enter into our mind. You need to control that and stomp them out. This is where the control of sin starts. It starts in the heart. In your heart, in my heart, in a woman's heart, in a man's heart. Everyone who falls into sin and fails in the Christian life failed first in their thoughts. They failed by the things they allowed themselves to think about and allowed to be in there. And without confession of sin, there will not be the control of sin in our hearts. And there will be no blessing on your life, and there will be no revival, and there will not be being used of God like you could be, and there will not be much reward in heaven. If you're hiding sin somewhere in the corners of your mind, it can be hid there as well as anything. Discipline of the heart and mind is absolutely essential if we're going to live for God. You say, "Well, it's not hurting anybody. Nobody knows about it." God knows about it. And He sees what we really are. And He's the one with whom we have to do, the Bible says. And some time ago, even in this church, I saw people mocking and laughing. And when they should have been weeping and mourning, because sin is not a joke. It's a joke in the world. Sin's a big joke. Everyone wants to laugh about that. But nothing can be more serious to God. It was sending us to a burning hell forever. It cost the Savior everything. You try to tell me something, it did not cost Him. It cost him everything as he left all the glory and the praise to come down and die among thieves on the cross in such horrible suffering and torment for our sins and be buried and risen again. It's so good to know him. We need to understand that we need to deal with sin in our lives. And so this psalm is all about that. It's about your foot slipping into a sin that you've already done. And David, it's a psalm of remembrance. David's saying, after all the things he went through, he said, I'm going to declare my sin. I'm not going to hide it anymore. And may God help us all do that. Psalm 17 is the second one. I'll go a little faster here maybe. Psalm 17 in verse 5. Verse 5 where it says, hold up my goings in thy paths, that my footsteps slip not. Now here's also a concern about falling into sin. It's a prayer, but it's not the same prayer. Nothing's more important in interpretation of the Bible than context. What do the other verses around it say? What is it talking about? Well, we'll see. It's not talking about the same thing. It's not talking about falling into the same sin again. Look at the first verse. Hear the right, O Lord. Attend, pay attention unto my cry. Give ear unto my prayer that goeth not out of feigned lips. Now, when you're praying, there shouldn't be pretending when we pray. Boy, that's when you ought to be real with God. And feigned lips has to do with the idea of not from the heart. But David said that it's not coming from a prayer that is not from the heart. It's coming from my heart. Let my sentence or the judgment of God come forth from thy presence, and let thine eyes behold things that are equal. And that's the balance that everything was weighed by, things that are equal. Watch, he says, verse 3, thou hast proved my heart. Thou hast visited me in the night when I was, at the time when we're alone. Thou hast tried me, watch this, and shall find nothing. I am purposed that my mouth shall not transgress. Now, these are wonderful things. We ought to always be like this. Be able to say, if God comes and looks, and I appreciate Grant and his song and his good voice and the truth of that, we ought to always be able to say, if God can look in my heart, he can't find anything. I'm determined to live holy and pure and do what is right before him. There's no wrong thoughts there. There's no thing in there that should be there. He has tried me, he says, and thou shalt find nothing. I am purposed that my mouth shall not be transgressed. And the easiest way to do something wrong is by the things that we say. But concerning the works of men, he says, by the word of thy lips I've kept me from the paths of the destroyer. I've stayed out. He said, I see where the destroyer works. People in sin, and then destruction comes into their life. And he says, concerning the works of men, what all the world is involved in, he said, I've kept myself away from being in the sinful path where the destroyer works. And then he says this, hold up my goings in thy paths. My goings is the steps. But hold up. Literally in the Hebrew it means reach down and get a hold of me and lift me up. When my kids were little, and they knew how to walk, but when we went into stores and through parking lots, I always made them, when they were little, hold my hand. They had to hold my hand. even all in the store, they had to hold my hand so I knew where they were. I remember with Faith walking along, Faith's our oldest, and walking along, and she'd trip, she was just like that. She's a big old feet on Faith, and just a little girl, but she'd trip and she'd just fall head first, and I would just hold her dangling by one hand. Just hold her dangling so she gets her feet back on the ground, and away we would go again. That is exactly what's being described here. David is saying to God, Lord, reach out. I know my feet are going to slip, so get a hold of me, God, and hold me up. Hold up my goings where? In thy paths. You say, well, all those verses ahead of that, that already tells us he was already in the paths of God. He was already doing what God wanted him to do. He already had confessed his sins. He was saved and he kept his sins confessed. But he said, I still can't do it. I still can't live this life. I need you to hold me up because I'm going to slip and fall down. This is keep me from slipping when you're doing well in your walk with God. So if you're doing really well and you even think you're doing well in your walk with God, no matter how well you may be doing, always plead with God to help you stay away from sin. Always plead with God to take care of us. Even in what people call the Lord's Prayer, which is the example of prayer, the Lord taught us to pray to be delivered from evil and lead us not into temptation. Don't let my heart go into temptation. And in 1 Corinthians 10:12, the Lord says, let him that thinketh he standeth take heed lest he fall. When we think we're doing well, you need to look out because there's no time when we can't fall. Always say, hold me up and protect my steps and grab me and support me that I slip not, because we can't take credit for anything in life. We can't take credit for what we are, even. You are the workmanship of Christ. We look at that in the Bible study this morning. You can't take credit. Oh, for a humble heart, because pride goeth before destruction and a haughty spirit before a fall. And Paul wrote in Philippians and said that you need to esteem others better than yourselves. We need to repent of our own strength. Do not walk in your own strength. Paul said, when I am weak, then I am strong. Then the opposite is also true. When I am strong, then I am also weak. And need the Lord to hold me up. Because you just need Him to hold you up all the time. And never see yourself as able to take care of you. But always pray and ask God so that you don't slip and don't end up into sin. In verse 7 of Psalm 17, he says, show thy marvelous loving kindness, O thou that savest by thy right hand them that put their trust in thee from those that rise up against them. We all need mercy. Thy marvelous loving kindness. The marvelous loving kindness is something separate from the regular loving kindness. It's a little bit different. It's the mercy of God and His kindness toward us. And it should be our plea that the Lord be merciful with us. And in the 4 minutes that are left, go over to Psalm 94 with me, if you would, please. And we'll look at the third one here really quickly. Psalm 94. If you look at pick it up at verse 4, it says, how long shall they utter and speak hard things? All the workers of iniquity boast themselves. They break in pieces thy people, O Lord, and afflict thy heritage. In other words, they're attacking people and hurting them, killing them. They slay the widow and the stranger and murder the fatherless. Yet they say, the Lord shall not see. Neither shall the God of Jacob regard it. Understand, you brutish. You're just like a beast, he says. Among the people, and ye fools, when will ye be wise? He that planted the ear, shall he not hear? He that formed the eye, shall he not see? He that chasteneth the heathen, shall he not correct? And he that teacheth man knowledge, shall he not know? The Lord knoweth the thoughts of man, that they are vanity. And then if we look down to verse 16, watch this, this is a great question. Who will rise up for me against the evildoers? Well, that's a good question. If you have people who want to do you evil, what are you going to do? Are you going to call your friends? Are you going to try to figure some way out of it on your own? David said, who's going to rise up for me against the evildoers? Or who will stand up for me? Who's going to stand up for you in this world against the workers of iniquity? Then this, unless the Lord had been my help, my soul had almost dwelt in silence. Dwelling in silence here is a reference to being dead. The dead are silent. He said, if the Lord hadn't helped me, and if He hadn't been my constant help, I don't know what I would have done. I would have been dead. When I said, My foot slippeth. Thy mercy, O Lord, held me up. Again, it's talking about foot slipping into sin. When I said my foot slippeth and asked the Lord for his help, then the Lord held me up. Again, he got a hold of me and lifted me up. We have no claim on mercy, but we can humbly ask for it and ask God for his help. What is this foot slipping here about? It's about when you're facing enemies. You know, when there's a great deal of stress or a great deal of problems or whatever the enemy might be, it might actually be a person, or it might just be what you're facing in life. You might be facing some diagnosis from the hospital, from the doctor. And it's an enemy. But when there's a great deal of pressure and stress in our lives, that's when we're apt to say things that we wouldn't normally say, do things, make decisions, snap decisions, even foolish decisions. I've seen some of God's people make the most foolish decisions. They come and ask their pastor, come and ask me, you know, what I should do. Told them what they should do the opposite. I don't know why you asked me, but anyway. But this is what happens. That's when you need to say, Lord, keep my foot from slipping. Hold me up now. If you've got a lot of problems, then I can guarantee you that somebody in this room is bearing a heavy load. You've got a lot of problems to deal with. Ask the Lord for his mercy. And now look at verse 19. In the multitude of my thoughts within me, thy comforts delight my soul. In the multitude of thoughts. You know, there's so many thoughts that come through our mind. This morning, I was thinking, as I was getting up, I was thinking about, well, if I was a police officer and I couldn't shoot somebody because then you get in trouble, how would I actually get people to stop? I wonder if you could just take a shot near them. And I thought, isn't that a foolish thing to think of? Why am I thinking of that? And the craziest things come through your mind sometimes. And one thought is not even connected to the other thought. And in all the things that come through your mind, David said, in the multitude of my thoughts, thy comforts delight my soul. Now, all the thoughts that come, there are still the thoughts of God taking care of me. And that is a comfort to me. Father, bless us today in your word.